Kelly. Diego, no, we're live. Today we're gonna have Diego Ave live with us to answer music industry producer questions. Let me turn this down a little bit. All right, so we're gonna be answering your music producer question, music industry producer question. Music industry, it sounds, you say it out loud five times, it sounds crazy. But the music industry, so producer from the industry, brought him in today, and we're gonna pick his brain on his experience and the questions that you have specifically for today. So here's his page on Instagram. If you want to follow him, it's Diego Ave. Just instagram.com/Diego Ave. Actually, I have to log into Zoom. So give me 1 second. I gotta get all these screens going. But what's up, everybody? Who's here? Brown Prince is here. We got DT is here. What's up? My bad. I forgot to log into Zoom. I have all these logins going on, forgive me here. And I gotta open up Discord. So if you guys would like to be a part of the conversation, you can actually join us via voice on your phone on Discord. If you have a question you wanna ask it live, you can do that through Discord. So let me set this up. All right, where's my screen? Oops, wrong button. Hold up, y'all. All right, so we are here. So I'm saying hello to everybody. What's going on? Let me switch this tab. A lot of tabs going on when you go live. It's about 17 tabs. We got Holiday here. KT is here. Pardon me. Hollow's here. What are the top things? We're going to get into your questions. It's best you come join us in the actual Discord. All right, so let me make sure I'm doing this right. Okay, so we're kicking up the Discord. Let me unmute. Forget how to do all this stuff. There we go. So I think if my mic's set up properly, you guys should be able to hear me on Discord. Let me just double check. Yeah, loop back. Boom, 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 boom. Okay. All right. So let me turn hand raising on just so we can get this thing rocking. So again, today we are going to pick the brains of Diego and get his real life experience. He's produced for a lot of top hip hop artists. So we're going to pick his brain live. I have him waiting, so let me actually get this thing going before he gets pissed. Okay, here we go. So we're on Zoom, and hopefully I got three mics going, so hopefully there's no feedback or anything like that. Who else has been here? We got Seydu, and we're going to get to you, Hollow, with your question. Seydu's here. We got J Pro Gaming. He says, hi, this is my first Busyworks Beat stream. Well, this is the one to watch. Big Roll is here. No feedback just yet. I don't know if we're going to do it tonight, but no feedback yet. What is this here? That's Discord. Today's a special episode. Let's put it that way. Mobile Music Pros here. Welcome. Wayne Beats is here. What's up? Carl Smith is here. I have watched your videos for a while. Well, thank you for hopping in with us live and hopping into the good conversation. Lemire is back. Welcome. Holiday says, I'm down. I'm download that. I don't know what that means, but I'm download too. Big Roller says, yeah, bro, I was ready. Here we go. T-shirts here. What's up? DT says, nice back. Oh, thank you. I'm just doing something random. This is from our last stream. Brown Rice is here. I have one question. So after Trap, we're going to get to your questions. Siraj is here. We got Digstown. We got A here. Roderick's here. All right, let me make sure. Here we go. Boom. All right, he is here in the building. Let me turn the music off so you can actually hear him. And then if I did everything right, you guys should be able to raise your hands in Discord to ask a question. I think I did it right. Allow requests. So if you want to come up, ask questions, just raise your hand and we're going to pull you into the conversation. Yeah, we don't need full screen. So actually, I can make this smaller and then use Discord to do it. Let's do it like this. How do I minimize this thing? Boom. Where'd it go? Where did the Zoom go? Hold up. Hello? Oh, shoot. I think I just X'd out of Zoom. Oh, no. Can you hear me? Mic check. Wait.
Hello?
Yeah, mic check. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I finally got you.
Okay, cool. I shrunk the screen and I couldn't find out where the little thing went. Okay, there we go. Now I got full screen Discord, so you're good to rock. We got Diego Ave on the line, ladies and gentlemen. I pulled up your Instagram, by the way. If you want to follow him on Instagram, the man has worked with a lot of the top acts in hip hop. Super plugged up and connected. So I'm going to say click here to follow Diego. But we're going to have a masterclass, basically, from an actually in the trenches music producer who's in the actual industry. And to give a little backstory, Diego did, I think, two masterminds with this, one in Miami and then one in Anaheim. You were just giving out gems. So I just appreciate you for even being that giving.
No, for sure.
Yeah, so thank you for being here. Thank you for hopping in with this. Let me say what's up to my Twitch folks real quick. And then they're going to, they already have questions. Like, this is already chopping at the bit.
Oh, wow.
See, dude, welcome on Twitch. We got, okay, who's the best rapper? Okay, we're not, that's not the greatest starting question. But no, shout out to you, man. Again, thank you for hopping on in. And everybody on Discord, you guys can raise your hands if you have a real question. But again, Diego, I just wanted to thank you because, again, you're in that same spirit as myself, which is a selfless giver. And I think that's why we attract so much like cool stuff. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, I mean, I love like giving back to up and coming producers and aspiring producers because, you know, I definitely haven't made this all this success by myself. I've had people help me all the time. You know, it's that's what it's all about. So I'm all for it, man. I'm excited.
Right on, right on. Now, Discord folks, let me know if you could hear Diego, and then Diego, let me know if you could hear on Discord. I'm going to pull up somebody and we're going to pick their brain. Magnum, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, man. Diego, can you hear that?
Yes, sir.
Oh, this is dope. Okay, we got a dope setup. Okay, perfect. So we're going to kick it off. We're going to serve you guys first. Again, me and Diego are really servants at heart. But Magnum, yeah, what's on your mind? Again, we got an industry pro on the line. This is not wasted time. So what's up, Magnum?
Hey, what's going on, man? It's nice to meet you, Diego. Appreciate you for having me on, Busy. I've been a fan for a long time. Just trying to learn from you and pick up what you drop in so I can understand this a little bit better because basically, like, when I make tracks, like, I'm all self-taught. So as far as creating a fuller sound and getting the attention of like higher level producers and things like that, like I can see the trends and I know how to follow them and everything, but my issue is looking at the spectrum on, because I use FL Studio, like looking at the spectrum and seeing how my sound can be fuller without overpowering.
Yeah, no, I get it. So for me, the easiest way to get your sound fuller is by using fewer sounds. So for me, my production is very simple, bro. I have probably one or two sounds max, and then drums and bass. So the less you put in your beats, once you throw the vocals in, the bigger it sounds, especially when you mix it, because you have so much more room. So now you have so much room in your spectrum for your 808 to hit. You got room for whatever one sound you pick or two sounds to take up more room. So to answer your question, if you want more room and a fuller sound, is use less sounds. Try to pick one sound that sounds like a hit instead of trying to stack things and put ambient sounds that just don't need to be there. Because once the vocals are in, you'll start noticing that the simple beats just feel bigger.
Mm, my bad. Yeah. Sorry, Magnum. You probably caught the second half because I didn't have Zoom linked in. But basically, you heard the majority of it, Magnum.
Yeah. Yeah, I heard him already. I appreciate the response, man. No. All right, I'm going to be sitting back and listening to, you know, all the responses and everything. If I got more questions, you know, my hand going to go back up. I'm going to be asking a bunch of questions. So just expect my hand to keep popping up.
I love the technical questions, though. That's dope. I'm excited for those.
Yeah, you're the voice of the people.
I came as an engineer first, so like I understand a lot about like frequency spectrums and compression. So you can get as nerdy as you want with the questions. I got you.
Right. And Magnum, right, is he loud enough on your end? I just want to make sure.
Yeah, I can hear y'all loud and clear. Okay. Loud and clear.
Yeah, because what he just gave y'all is a gem. He just basically said the reason we overcompensate is because there's no vocal. Am I hearing you right, Diego?
Exactly. You're instead of you're trying to make the full beat without the vocal, and you're just adding too much sound. And all those sounds I know it's weird to hear it, but the more sounds you add, the smaller your beat gets, not bigger, especially when you're mixing it. So that was just saying less sounds give you a bigger beat, give you more room to have a bigger sounding piano, a bigger sounding 808. If you start adding all these extra instruments, your music becomes smaller. It's like Phil Spector, it's the wall of sound. I like work the opposite of that. It's having minimal sounds. That's how I like to work.
Oh, okay. See, that's counterintuitive. We think bigger sound, layer 18 melodies to make it sound full. That's actually make it really sound,
yeah, it's crazy.
Well, Magnum, I mean, you got the mic. If you have another question, then we're going to pull from the YouTube chat. But again, anybody on Discord, if you want to ask a question live, you can, you're free to come up. I'll take YouTube questions right next. But Magnum, whatever's on your mind, you got the floor.
I bet. So my next question is I'm about to pull up FL Studio.
We got an FL. Right, okay. Wait, Diego, which DAW is your primary DAW?
Oh, I use FL.
Oh, dope.
Super I've dope. Used every DAW, but FL is pretty much my final destination in my career.
You're right on, FL gang. Somebody said, how many? Bet. Oh, go ahead.
Oh, yeah, I was going to ask, all right, so using a multi-band compressor, because that's what a friend of mine told me, that's my issue, using a multi-band compressor in the low end of the spectrum in order to make your 808 sound like have that high-end, I don't want to say punch, but that not drone sound, but you know how that 808 has a drone sound kind of sticking out, but you still got the kick at the bottom?
Okay.
How do you use a multiband compressor in that effect with the 808?
I don't use multiband compressors for any low end. That's me, my personal preference. Now, there's so many ways to get your 808s to hit. There's so many different tricks. Me, I can tell you what I personally like because I have a specific sound. If you've noticed the last 2 years, I don't even use kicks in my music. That's just my personal preference. I don't like kicks. So doing that allows me to have a lot more room to push my 808. And you'll realize you don't need a kick once you push the 808 a certain way. And if you pick the right one as well. So what I do is I just put a compressor. I don't use a multiband compressor. A multiband compressor I like to use on vocals and stuff that takes up more of the frequency spectrum on the high end. So I'll put a light distortion first on the 808. I like to use trash, but there's a lot of cool ones. And then I'll throw I use the regular basic compressor that comes with FL. I love how it just makes it sound like it brings out the low end, the sub, like I would say 100 and down. It brings that up from your 808. So that's really it. But experiment with the multiband compressor. If you like it, if it works for you, I just wouldn't compress too much. I think more than about 2 to 3 dBs on the 808, you're just squashing it at that point of gain reduction.
All right, so. When you say all right, so yeah, I'm about to get real technical now. I don't know if you are ready for that. All right, so my threshold, normally I was told use a range of negative 20 dB, ratio, I forgot, but I was using 7 to 1 and 10 to 1 and gain 2 and 0. My release 90 milliseconds and attack 27. And it ranges from there, when I'm trying to get the sound just right, for that particular track. But that's a baseline for what I was kind of taught, going on what I've, what I've been around, because I never actually really gotten in depth with it. So speaking from a complete amateur, somebody who's just completely going off the cuff doing this, what would you say to that, how I explained the compressor right there?
So your ratio, you can turn your whatever sound you're compressing, you can turn it to a limiter just by putting your ratio at infinity or turn it all the way up. Right. So for me, I don't use limiters either. So I usually keep it at around 2 to 3 on the ratio. And then your threshold, there's no possible way you can have a set threshold, because you have to adjust that according to the sound. Every sound is different. Some come in hotter, some come in more quiet. So that's the threshold you have to adjust according to how hot the sound is. So that's a good starting point, but make sure you adjust that threshold. So you don't want to compress more than 3 dBs. That's me personally. Again, there's no rules to music. You can do however you want to do it. But for me, I don't like to compress more than 3 dBs per compressor, if that makes sense. So just adjust your threshold to you just use the compressor so it, it kisses the sound instead of squashing it. I use several compressors. Like when I was mixing vocals, for example, I would use 5 to 6 compressors, but each one, instead of squashing it with one, I'm doing gradual compression per each one, and it sounds fuller. It doesn't sound squashed.
Right. That helps. Yeah, that was high level. Just to explain it to everybody else, is you said it perfectly with the kiss analogy, is that 3 dB, you can just hear the volume dip. Once you go past 3 dB on average, it just sounds like it's pulling down the sound, and you don't really hear as much like dipping. It just sounds like it's just pulling it down, if that makes sense. But no, I love Diego, because Diego pulled me in a session with Rico Love. I want to appreciate you for that. And also Super Dupes and a lot of other dope folks introducing me to. And in the set, I mean, I don't want to go into the details, but there was a record that you played. And I remember you were like, man, the 808 was way harder in your mix than the final, you know, mix that came back.
Yeah, it happens a lot.
Yeah, so it's interesting to see the levels. But thank you, Magnum. We got two other folks. We got Docs Hitmaker. Before we get to Docs and Hitmaker, you guys have the floor next. I want to get to the YouTube chat so they don't feel left out. Lemire says, can y'all talk? Oh, thank you, Magnum. You can chill up here if you want. There's no hierarchy or anything. It's open chat. But Lemire says, can y'all talk about analog synths and the difference between analog and software? So in your experience, I'll rephrase this for everybody else. How do I put this?
Such a good question.
Yeah. Do you see it? Do you see people like renting analog gear when you go to sessions and stuff?
So for me, what I've noticed is the analog gear, a lot of like sample makers and loop producers, which is a new thing in the game right now.
Sorry, my bad.
No, you're good. Hello. So yeah, a lot of the sample makers, they like to mess with those like analog synths because they could run it through different amps and all kind of hardware equipment before it touches whatever DAW they're using to record it in. So it makes sense, you know, in that aspect. You can hear a difference. It does sound. I've personally heard a difference when I've used like a Mellotron versus the actual software. It sounds grimier, just sounds clean. I don't know how to explain it. I feel like it sounds better, but I'm all about efficiency. And if I'm not using like a loop guy, I'm just kind of building my own sound, I'll probably just stick with the software, man. Like, it's close enough. I feel like the common listener is not going to hear that difference. And there's so much like other plugins you can use nowadays that add like harmonic distortion and all kind of pitching and things like that. You can off detune it and you can make it sound still like it's a hardware. So for me, I'm always going to be software. I like moving forward. I don't like going backwards in time, you know, but you know, everyone's different. That's just me personally. I like to be in the box. I pull up to a session with a laptop and a mouse and that's it.
Right. No, true. I mean, he's not lying. I was shocked. Diego literally just had a laptop and a pair of earbuds, not even like headphones. And then he was making a beat or whatever he was doing. And then they played it over the speakers. I was like, how in the world did you get this track to sound this hard over some headphones, some earbuds or whatever it was? That was wild. I was like, this man is insane. You could literally just pull up with the laptop. Yeah, because real quick, Diego, I think the dream for most at-home producers is that they're like, okay, next step, I want a commercial studio. Next step, I got to have a big studio. I got to go to the big studio. You know, like, but then when you get to the big studio, you could tell us your experience is that you realize you're just plugging a laptop into a big like control center, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, it also depends on what genre of music you're doing as well, because like I've done like some R&B, some country, even some pop, where you might want to have a drummer come in, and that's when you can use the console. And you know, maybe you want to have a vocalist playing with the guitars at the same time. It all depends on what you're doing. But I mean, I have been kind of a hip-hop based producer for the last couple of years, so for that, I would say I would just stay in the box, keep everything simple. You don't need much equipment. Just try to, I would just save your money to just to get some software. You know, the hardware stuff gets expensive, man.
Very true. Goodness. I'm looking at these keyboards like, y'all need to pay rent because all this money put in this hardware. No. So yeah, I'm going to open up for the floor to either Hitmaker, Docs, and it looks like I accidentally muted Samurai. My bad, Luca. It was a little interruptive when you came up the first time. So I didn't mean to be rude and drop you. It was just, we were on a flow. But Docs, you are welcome to say what's on your mind. What's going on, buddy?
What's up, bro?
Yo, I got a question.
Hold on, Samurai. We're on Docs. What's up, Docs?
Yo,
So I just wanted to know, like, so I use FL Studio, right? As a lot of people do when they either start off and stuff like that. But a lot of studios and stuff use like Ableton and stuff like that. I know there's a difference in like ease of how do I put this? Like the easiest way to like start off, you know what I mean? Like it's easy to use, intuitive is what I'm trying to say. And FL has been, it's not like, obviously it's not possible to use, but I've used Ableton as well, and it's like there's a big difference. So I just want to know why you stick to FL anyway, when there's, you know, I'm not saying like FL's bad, I use FL too, but I just wanted to know like why do like big studios and, you know, big producers use stuff like Ableton and other stuff like that? Is it like ease of use, or like is there more stuff
No,
you can do with it, or what?
it really depends. It really depends on the kind of music you're making, in my opinion. So, for example, I know a few producers that do amazing R&B music, right? They're keyboard players and they can play anything from left to right. I always recommend them to use Logic, and a lot of them do because Logic is great for MIDI. It has a great MIDI setup and all that stuff. So, like, I know a few like loop makers, for example. They use Able. A lot of them use Ableton because the flexibility of the audio. And you could flip it so quick, and it's really audio friendly to me. So, like I said, depends on what you're doing. For me, I do a lot of like, I finish the beats. I'm gonna do the drums. I'm a drum bass producer first. I start with drums most of the time, and then I figure out the music after. So for me, I just like the flow of FL because it's the closest thing to an MPC if you think about it, because it has a pattern. Then you go to song mode. It's very similar to the MPC style where you just knock out the idea real quick and move on to the next. I feel like with
That's
Ableton,
true.
it makes you think too much, where you want to just keep adding and adding and adding, and you start to overcomplicate your music. Again, that's just my opinion, and that's why I use FL. But yeah, every DAW has its perks, man. Like the audio in Ableton is amazing.
That was deep. Yeah, I just want to reiterate this because you said a lot, and I want to make sure the beginners understand what you said. Basically, you're saying FL, and I remember you saying this, Diego. You're like, FL, the drums is hit. The way you can program your drums hits. Now I know the compressor is one of the secrets. Ableton is, like you said, you can mess with the audio and cut it very easily. It's just built for loops and built for samples like that, and time stretch and all that type of stuff. And then, like you said, Logic is for players because they know how to just play it in. And it has really good starting sounds. I want to pull it qu real quick, Docs, before you finish on your second question. Ali B to King from YouTube says, a guide on how to. Okay, let me ask this question. Are you in charge of, is it the responsibility of a producer to deal with the vocals of an artist? Like, for example, Diego, if you're booking a session with somebody, do you go, I can make a beat and then I can also like guide the song? Like, how do you, is that part of your program, or do you like to separate it?
Well, I always recommend for anybody that makes beats, if they can get into a session with an artist and they're lucky enough to have that opportunity, always push more than just trying to make the beat and watch and just sit back. Always try to like take control of the room, try to guide and vocal produce, because that's going to make the artist respect you more, and he's going to want you to come back and do a lot more work for him, because they like that's a big part of being a producer, not just like cranking out beats, you know what I mean? So sometimes I'll take a beat that's not even my beat, and I'll place it in the room. I'll play it for the artist, but then I'll produce it out. I'll take out stuff I don't like from the beat after. I'll arrange the song and build the song out. I'm still the producer, but you know, it give like I'm in with the artist. I don't want to just I could have just sent the beat if that's the case. If I'm in with you, I want to build with you and create a song with you. So always push for that because you'll get the call back from an artist for sure.
Oh, right on. I love that because real quick anecdote is some of the people I remember the most are the engineers. I don't know what it is, maybe because they're there the most, but you know, Andy, shout out to Andrew Grossman, Gross Face Killer, and shout out to Ed from what's that place in New York? I forgot the name of the place, but shout out
Even
to Ed.
the
Engineer room. What, say it one more time?
I said the engineers have all the ideas.
Maybe so, maybe so. I'm gonna let somebody else get a chance to speak. Luker, I'm gonna give you a second chance. Forgive me, I just had you on mute
All
because
right.
it was just the
So
timing.
I have like two questions because number one, why every single track? Like I was listening to like Feeder Polythene or like the Jackson 5 Get It Together. Like, why every single track has to start from beginning to the end? And number two, is an album is called a, like, is it like a chapter book or a studio album? Are they the same? Are they the different? Because some people say like they're the same, they're different. What's your honest opinion about that?
Well, let's start with one question at a time, because I'll get overwhelmed. So the first one is, can you re-say the first question again?
The first one is why every single track has to start from beginning to the end.
It's an interesting question. Thank you. Yeah, I guess
I don't think I understand that question, to be honest. Yeah. Why does every track have to start from beginning to end? Versus what? Yeah. Well, how else would they start?
I guess what do you, let me rephrase
it. Like, say, Shake Your Body Down to the Ground by the Jacksons was like 8 minutes long. I don't know why do I have to play that track from beginning to the end, because it's so long.
Interesting question. I'm going to tuck you real quick. I think what his question is this. There's two different types of songs. There's song, like when you're playing melodies, there's some melodies you can play with a piano straight. You can just hop on the piano and play it. But modern hip hop, it requires manipulation of a sample. So I'll rephrase the question for like our greater audience. Diego, how many of the melodies do you see a straight play through? Like somebody can just replay it? And how much of it is, you know, twisting it, stretching it, reversing it, all that type of processing?
I mean, honestly, bro, like I said, there's no rules in music. You can do it however you hear it. For me, I like simple music. I don't like things played too complicated. I don't like things that's like too many changes. That's me personally. I know back then they had so many different sections of a record where they have the intro, verse, pre-hook, hook, post-hook, then they have verse two, then the hooks again, and then the bridge, and then a coda. They had so many different sections. So like, I think we're at a place now musically where it's, bro, there's only, sometimes they even do one verse and that's the end of the song, or they'll do a verse, a hook, a feature, done. Like there's, I think the rules are out the window now where songs are getting shorter, arrangements is gone, you know, but I feel like that's where we're at now. But yeah, I mean, I'm not sure if that answers your question, but yeah, back then they had so many different kind of, I would say, chord progressions and builds ups and all that. That stuff to me is kind of like, it's cool. It's just, I like making popular music right now, so I try to keep it as simple as possible. I try not to use more than like 3 to 4 chords for the whole record. I don't like too many different changes. I do 3 changes on a beat and then that's it. After that, it's too many changes.
Right. And then Luker, I put you on mute real quick just to organize the chat a little bit. So forgive me on that. I think a lot of, if we just think, I'll keep it short. Historically, the only way we could really hear music was to see it live or to have a vinyl. And remember back in the day, they used to stuff CDs a lot with filler tracks. So the more time you spent on a track, the more filler you had, basically. And if you're performing for an hour, you want a song that's 10 minutes because that's, you only have to perform 6 songs. So I think a lot of the songs were based on the commercial output. Hence why our songs now are shorter, because the commercial output is now TikTok, is now a short form video. So it's, yeah, it's all built on the output. Seymour asked the question. Seymour asked the question. He says, to achieve an R&B sounding track, is it necessary to have an analog keyboard or would VSTs be enough? So I guess he's asking you your sound selection for R&B.
Well, R&B is, see, it depends on what kind of R&B you're making as well. Cause like I do mess with R&B music, but how I produce it is I try to modernize it. So I like to keep, like, for example, the drums, instead of being like laid back in those same like slow patterns, I try to turn it up and figure out a way to make it turn where you could have an R&B singer and then maybe a rapper could go on it. That's how I like to do my R&B music. So that being said, I like to, I don't really use analog synths unless if I work with a sample producer and he sends me stuff, maybe he uses analog synths to send me those loops and then I'll chop it and do what I do with it. But me personally, I stay in the box. And then you can, nowadays, these plugins are great, man. Like you can, with Kontakt alone, you can have stuff sounding like it's right out of the box, like super like sampled and recorded live. Like you can do everything in the box, bro.
Right. Yeah, the sample makers are the ones who experiment with the sound and buy all the, you see Count always doing those sample videos. Shout out to Eli. Shout out to God Bless Eli. Shout out to Waves. All the sample makers, Jacob, my best friend Jacob. They really study guitar pedals, all that type of stuff. They're the crazy scientists.
Yeah, musicians, man. Shout out to them, bro. They're a central part of music. There, I heard it's funny because Jetson said something on a tweet, which I've been saying this for a while. I'm glad somebody actually said it, that loop makers and sample makers are the writers to producers, as how writers are to artists. It's crazy when you think about it.
Exactly. That is funny. Because Diego, I want to ask you a question. That's actually a dope segue. Is here's what people don't understand, because they're at home and they have no clients and they just have all the time in the world. When you actually are on a time schedule, like I'm trying to squeeze out as much value with you before the hour, you have to like get stuff done efficiently. There's no time to be sitting there making a melody every single session from scratch, unless that's what the artist or whoever you're with wants. So right. Do you see loops as more of a proficient way to operate, if that makes sense?
Absolutely. Yeah, this is a numbers game. So like you have to have thousands of beats. You can't just have 20 beats and try to sell them, because every artist has a particular sound and you have to tailor make it for them. You might already have it, but the chances of you having it become lower if you have 20 beats in your arsenal. You got to have thousands and keep creating, because you just never know which beat will be the one to change your life. So yeah, I'm like always cooking new things so that I'm always prepared. But yeah, you got to have a quick output too. So like some producers like to make 20 beats a day. That's obviously them using loops. But for me personally, I try to do like 4 to 5 on a good day. And so I'd say half of those would be me running through some dope samples. And the other half is me probably just cooking from scratch or even using Splice. I love Splice.
Oh yeah, shout out to Splice. I have an actual side question off of that question, which is, since when you're in the industry, I'll say there's a lot of separated roles, whereas people who are at home, you have to mix and master your own stuff. But in the industry, you don't mix and master your own stuff. So do you have a problem? Let's say you have a question. Now I forgot what I was saying. Let's say you have an idea, Diego, a production, and then somebody else goes back and they rearrange it. Is that something that you like or don't like? Does that make sense?
Sometimes if I send in a beat pack to an artist and I can't physically be there, they do what they want with that beat. Like sometimes they'll chop it and they'll make the intro, the outro, they'll do whatever they want with it. And you know, teachers, I'm not married to any of my work. So like if somebody wants to do what they hear on it with me starting the idea, by all means, you know, do what you got to do. Let's get the placement. You shouldn't have emotions about that kind of stuff. It's a business at the end of the day.
Mm-hmm. Right, because because even the reason I asked that is because online producers, they try to push the narrative of, in their contracts, they'll put this beat, you can buy the stems and the everything for it, but you can't rearrange it. They prevent and prohibit rearrangement, but that's with the beat leasing community. So I was just curious your take. Here's a question from Digstown. We're going to go to YouTube real quick. YouTube Land says, hey, what is the best way to send beats to an artist? Like, should you load up a whole terabyte drive and send it, or a thumb drive? So basically, yeah, that's a good question.
How do you give you're saying what's the best format to send beats to an artist? One, it depends on your connection to the artist. Do you have a direct connect to him where you have his cell phone number, or do you have his A&R's email? Like how are you sending it? Now for me, I send beats through text message directly to artists. That's how I like to do it, because it's quick, it's easy. They're always on their phone. They see a message from me and like, oh, cool, some new beats. And they check it out. And if they're in the studio, even better, they're going to pull them up. If you're sending, and I don't send more than like 6-7 beats max. Anything more than that, you're going to overwhelm them. You know, and they're not going to go through all those beats. You know what I mean? Especially the bigger artists, they're not doing that. If I'm sending beats to someone like Drake, I'm sending him 4 beats max.
Right.
If I'm sending to an A&R, I'll probably send a little bit more, because they might pick their favorite and they'll kind of filter it out and then send it to the artist. So I might send an A&R like 10 MP3, and always make sure your name is attached to every single MP3 and the tempo.
Thank you. Goodness. I've been trying to preach. I'm like, please put your name on MP3s, because people download stuff off of YouTube all the time. And if your name's not on it, they're not going to remember where they got it from. I'm like, put the Instagram key.
Just put at and whatever your name is. So sometimes I can't even find you by your name. If you put your at, I'll be able to find you on Instagram and DM you.
Yeah, please. Those silly names do not work. I mean, they may work, but please have that information in the title. And also I would recommend the key, and like you said, the BPM, because when people are loading up auto-tune. BPM. Yeah.
For sure.
That auto-tune struggle, if they can't find the key, they're going to say next. So Marty says, isn't a song. Oh, actually, let's take a question from Discord. I was doing the YouTube thing. I think we had either Hitmaker was up before Hollow, and then Samurai. So Hitmaker, I don't know if your mic's active, but I can't hear you.
Oh, hey, can you guys hear me?
Oh, there you go. There you go. Yes.
Oh, yeah, I have it on Push to Talk. Hey, first things first, you know, I appreciate you for letting me, you know, ask my questions. And, you know, Diego, you taking the time to, you know, answer these questions, everything. I did have a couple questions because, like, a lot of the times, a lot of things I struggle with is kind of more the low end, you know, on some of my tracks that, you know, just a lot of things will just, like, clash. And it just sounds, like, just muddy or just doesn't sound right when it hits. But then other sections, it'll just sound good. I mean, one thing I've just been looking into is more like sidechain compression. I'm not sure if that's something that, you know, you use or something that you would recommend using for trying to help balance out some of the lows, like if certain two lower end sounds are clashing together.
Okay, so I have a few ways
to Hell yeah. I'm sorry, before you start, I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt. Could you please explain how to do the side chain while you do that? Thank you. I'm sorry for interrupting.
I mean, more so like, because I've been trying to look at certain ways to help like my low end kind of like mix or sound like a lot better together. I mean, I'm not sure if that's going to be like EQing, you know, some of my lower end sounds that's not like the bass so that the bass just sounds like a little more full whenever I'm, you know, making a track.
Okay, so first thing I do is I send all my music, everything that's music that's not drums, hi-hats, or 808 to an aux, to a bus. And then on that bus, first thing I do is I EQ by taking out all the low. I do a high-pass filter all the way up to about 100. And then you could even duck it even to like 150, 200. You could give a little, like a second little notch and duck some of that too. And then I put a compressor after that just to tighten up all the music. That alone should make your 808s have so much more room to breathe and be able to really hit. So that'll be the thing where you said you had sections where it would sound good and wouldn't. That's an EQ thing with your music. Secondly, with the side chaining, again, I don't use kicks in my music. I'm more about picking the right 808. That's just how I do like my sound. Everyone has their own different sound. I know some engineers like to use that trick where they put a kick and side chain it. If I did use a kick, I probably would just try to pick a better kick that matches the 808 more, because some 808s might have a little knock already in the front of it, and that could mess with the kick and 808s being together, or picking a different 808 towards your kick. You know, you might have a fat kick that has like super low end that has like hitting the sub. Maybe EQ some of that low end from the kick and let the 808, you know, have that room. It's all about room. You're building a house, so you have to give every section room to be itself, you know, if that makes any sense.
Wait, I want to give Diego props. He just gave you all the master key to solving a lot of your masking issues. Just to reiterate, that was a huge thing real quick, Magnum, is that, you know, people don't realize the buildup of the low end from all the, you know, ancillary instruments. And then on top of that, he gave you the key of, ducking. What did you say? You said add a compressor. You said something else after that.
Add the EQ first.
Compression, because ducking a low pass on your music instead of the end, like no drums.
Yeah, something else you said, Diego. Oh, here's what you said. Sorry, Diego. I'm mixing up the message. Forgive me. Is you said the kick is sometimes embedded in the 808. And as a sound designer, that's exactly true. That's why a lot of your stuff is clashing. There's a actual kick inside the 808. So I'm glad you said that. That's huge. Didn't mean to cut your thoughts. So who was up next? We got either Samurai, you've been waiting a long time, and then we're gonna hop to the YouTube chat to pick their brain. I mean, excuse me, to grab a question from them. So Samurai, you're up. You're up the bat. If you can hear me. Samurai going once, going twice. We can't hear you. All right. So Hollow, it's up. It's on you, Hollow.
Hey, there you go.
All right, so first thing that I wanted to say to build off of what he was saying is with low end, I've also found is on your master channel, cut around 20 to 25. It can range from 20 to 40 hertz, and it will drastically make your mix sound better and less money. But my main question to ask is, so I'm actually going to be going to music school, and a lot of people keep discouraging me against that. And do you think that it's right for them to discourage me from going to music school, or do you think it's a experience that's worth it?
Yeah, I can tell you got a mic. Sorry.
When you say music school, you mean like actual music or engineering school? Like
yes, exactly? I'll be going to AIMM, Atlanta Institute of Music and Media. So I'll be taking a degree course, and not a certificate, but an actual degree course on, I forget the exact name, but they'll be teaching you theory, engineering, production as a whole, and also the business aspect of everything.
I went to engineering school myself, and I don't regret it because I learned a lot of things that I needed to learn, and it helped me in my production. It helped me land my internship at a studio that helped start my career. So I'm never against any kind of education. You should always educate yourself on everything. As far as people discouraging you, people are going to tell you not to do music your whole life. You just got to do whatever you feel like is right in your life. Like I've had people tell me all the time, like, you're crazy, you're going to starve to death. And I'm buying my third home now, so I don't know about that. So right, do whatever you feel, man. It's on you.
There. Right. Because, he's exactly right. Think about all the programming we have from middle class. We were told not to take risks, to go to college and magically have a job that pops up at the end. This is all programming to keep folks poor. It's just like genetics. Genetics are passed on to the kids. Your mentality is passed on to you from your parents, unfortunately. And we have to unlearn all that stuff and get into reality. This is why it's so important to have people like Diego who are actually creating the results that you guys say you want. I'm like, if y'all don't believe me, I'm going to pull in friends of mine so you can hear it directly from their mouth.
Yeah. And not even to like make it, I'm not even trying to make it a thing, but I actually, like, I was working as I was in high school to pay for my audio engineering school. So I definitely came from humble beginnings. I never had someone to like, oh man, I'm having a bad year, can I sleep on your couch? None of that. So it was me, make it or don't make it, be homeless. So when you have that kind of pressure, you figure it out, man. So just have faith in yourself that if you need to figure it out, you're going to figure it out. There's always a way.
Right on.
Yeah, I appreciate that, man.
Awesome. We got a mindset question coming from Lemire. He's asking the good questions. And then we'll go to
I got a question.
Yeah, real quick.
I got some questions.
Gotcha. We're going to come to you right after the YouTube question. So Lemire, his question is, in general, how do you feel about music theory, Diego?
I think it's very useful to make records for sure. I have enough theory where I can play on a beat. I know what the right key is for 808s. I can play progressions. And to me, that's all I think is needed to make beats. I mean, the more you know, the better, obviously. I was self-taught myself. I'm not like a professional keyboard player, but I can get around. So yeah, I always recommend, like I said, education. So yeah, I'm all for music theory. You can't make a hit record without chords, in my opinion. Mm-hmm.
Right. Oh. True. Think about all the 808, like the new genre of music where it's just 808 and drums, like that doll type music. I don't know the word for it. But yeah, it's.
Hey, Busy.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Busy.
Don't you have a number chord thing?
The chord code chart. Yeah. So if anybody's interested, just go to busyworksbeats.com/musictheory for the chord code chart. 037. Close. But thank you.
True. Yeah, you're right. Right.
I don't want to make this about myself. I want to, because we have Diego only for 1 hour, so I got to make sure we're efficient with the time. Samurai, real quick, if you can hop back in. We just couldn't hear you before, Samurai.
My bad. The reason why you couldn't hear me is because I didn't have a certain sending zone gone, and this is my sync time when working the clubhouse. But I got three questions, and this is about melodies. Okay, so when you're making the melodies, how are you sure that you're not keying in the same notes or the same types of notes? And when you're making a melody, what is the best program to like monitor the melody and put on the melodies? And when you're making the melodies, what is the best mixing technique for the melodies?
All right, yeah, you got a lot of questions, so I'm gonna feed them to him, to Diego, one at a time. So the first question was basically, how do you know you're not recreating a melody that's in your subconscious? Like maybe you heard it from a different song and you don't even know. type of thing.
Yeah. Because when I make,
hold on, Samurai. We got a limited time, so I just can't let you go on. Forgive me. We only have.
Yeah, I got minutes. You. So look, how I do melodies, bro, is two different ways. Because I do know how to play the keys a little bit, so I'll start either on the keyboard, try to find something catchy that goes along with either my drums. Because I start with the drums first, and or I do like drums and chords, and then whatever the melody is, the catchy part that you can whistle or hum, I either do on the keyboard. I'll record it and tweak it, quantize it back on FL, or I'll just click it. I'll just try different notes, and I don't really think about, oh, I've done this before, I haven't done this before. I just do what feels right. Like, if you've done it before, so what? Flip it a little bit, halftime it, try messing with it. Do a melody, bounce it to audio, run it through like halftime, or try doing triplets from the halftime plugin. Like, just mess with it and just play around till you get something that's just catchy. Something, as long as you can hum it or whistle it, that's a good thing in your beat. If you can't find something in your beat that you can sing to or anything that's like catchy like that, it's just another beat.
Oh, that was big bars. That was big bars. Because the singability, I'm just getting geeky with it, is the way that it translates to somebody else. Can you sing it? And then your friend hears it and they can sing it too. Really deep. And now the second question from Samurai was mixing the melodies. Do you, Diego, do you think of melody mixing as creative or more technical? Does that make sense?
It's technical. I know amazing producers that don't even mix their beats at all. They just bounce it. They don't even put a limit or nothing. So it depends on how like technical you want to get with it. I try to be 50% technical, you know, because I'm still an engineer at heart deep inside. So I'll run, like I said, I run all my music through an aux. And that way I don't have to sit there and mix every sound. That's too much work. It takes away the creative process. So I just throw everything through an aux and just do like a sub mix, which is close enough to it to translate to a really good sounding mix of a beat. You know what I mean? So then I just do a compressor or any kind of compression to tighten up the music, and then some kind of EQ to either brighten it or whatever it is. Sometimes it's too muddy. You just do a quick little notch EQ thing and boom, you're done.
Boom. I love it. I love
what's an aux? What's
an aux? It's,
yeah.
So that's what we're short on.
If I get my second question.
We got to go to YouTube real quick. I love you, Docs, for hopping on in with the enthusiasm. I really love that. I just want to make sure everybody feels they're participating. Lemire asked on YouTube, do you feel like sample makers choose analog sounds because of their attention to detail, tone, and quality? Kind of like AI hug. I don't know what that means. But basically, do you think that the quality and experimentation is more on the sample makers, or is that a producer thing? Does that make sense, Diego?
Yeah, it's kind of broad. I get what you're saying. I feel like, because like I said, I do both too. I can make a sample for my own beat. So I am like a big into details. But yeah, most sample makers, at least the good ones, they really craft the sound. And that's why they choose analog gear, because you can really craft the sound with all the hardware, EQing, compression, and the oscillators. So like they can mess around with so many things that just sound different when you have like hard equipment. But to each his own, man. Like it's to each his own on how you like to work. They both, you can make hits with both. That's all that matters.
True. And he's seen them literally work with the top artists in hip hop and in the world, actually. Jamie,
I've made records with piano keys, the FL keys that come with FL. Like that's I made a lot of big records with that. So it doesn't matter as long as it feels good.
Bars. Really?
Yeah. Real quick though, we got questions from YouTube. Jamie Scott says, my music sounds too video gamey. Any tips to make it more modernized but still stay true to the theme? Anyway, basically his songs sound too video gamey. Do you have any tips for him, Diego?
Yeah, just use different plugins. You're probably using synth plugins. Maybe try some more plugins like Mellotron that have more of a hardware sound, like you have like choirs and brasses and more organic instruments. That'll get rid of the like the EDM sounding sounds and stuff like that.
I like this. We're in the hot seat mode, so I'm taking YouTube questions real quick. Mirko says, do you agree with the fact that the rhythm is the foundation of melody? The melody makes it bounce, but needs drums to complement. What do you think bounces the track? I mean, in general, I know we're generalizing. Is it the melody or the drums, you think?
He answered his own question. I mean, it's not just the melody, it's the rhythm of the melody, and the drums just kind of top it off. So he really answered his own question. But right. Yeah, I agree with you.
Super dope. Okay, now my fault. Docs and Magnum, you have the floor for the last couple of questions, and we got to wrap at the hour. And by the way, we had 120 folks here on YouTube, by the way, and then 20 folks here on the Discord. So I think there's 140 folks in total. So nice. You have a large audience. So, yeah.
Are you go ahead, Magnum, go first.
All right. So my question, two of my questions are, what's the aux that you were talking about earlier? And like, how do you bust an FL20? Because I've been looking for that and I don't know what I'm doing wrong. I can't find it.
Aux,
all right. So in the math, like in the, yeah, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
The aux is the bus. It's the same thing. Aux is short for the auxiliary, which is it's a term that came from hardware mixers.
Right. So the short of it.
Yeah. So what do you find in the mixer?
Yeah. Real quick. I don't want to eat up a lot of time. The real short answer is highlight all the tracks that you want in your mixer, and then find that up arrow that's at the bottom of an empty channel, and then right click, and it says route to this track only, and then that will route all those tracks to one thing. That's how you group. I'll show you guys in a different video. I just don't want to eat up time right now. Docs.
No problem. I got you. Thank you.
Yeah, yeah. What's your last thoughts?
All right. So do you think that it's worth learning actual instruments in order to, I make a lot of hip hop shit, you know what I mean? Stuff like that. But do you think it's worth learning actual instruments just in case of anything else, like you want to broaden it out? Or do you think it's more worth it if you're going down a certain path like hip hop to just stick with software?
No, if you feel like you want to learn like guitar or something like that, that's always a perk, man. Don't ever hold yourself back. Always learn as much as you can. If I could, I'd learn the guitar. I just don't have time. But yeah, learn as much as you can while you have the time.
Because I know how to play saxophone. I played saxophone for years, and I play drums. But shit, yeah, so I learned guitar, piano, stuff like that.
Sax on the come up after Drake's album. That intro had that sax line. I was like, all sax players are rubbing their hands like Birdman right now. Two questions.
Go crazy.
I love that. And you guys can connect with Diego on Instagram. I put his Instagram in the YouTube chat, and he even was kind enough to share his email. If you guys want to send loops and sax stuff or whatever it is, just check the announcements tab. Okay, so Mirko asked, when usually do you feel, how do you know that a beat's done, Diego?
You just know, man. Like, you just, it's just one of those things where you know. What I do is when I'm making a beat, I kind of like mumble rap over it as I'm doing it. And if I feel like it feels right and it just sits where there's enough room for the vocal to slap on top, it's done. If you start to overthink it, you're going to just add things that aren't necessary. So when you feel like he's missing something, it's part of the vocal. That's all it is. So if you're stuck on it, move on to another beat, come back, and you're going to hear it fresh. And it's almost like you're collabing with yourself because you're hearing it fresh for the first time, and you'll end up finishing it every time. So that's a good trick I always do. Always come back to a beat the same with, like, skip it for an hour, work on something else, work on five ideas, then go back to them one by one, and you'll hear it fresh ears.
Man, that's just why I just appreciate Diego, because he's super concise and he gives you those militant points that actually level you guys up. There's another dope question real quick. This is the last question from YouTube, and then we're going to have ending thoughts here. This is Raging Oracle. He says, if you had to create a generalized sound selection for each beat, let's say hip hop beat, I know it's all over the place, but if you had to say, here's the basic formula for starting material to create a hip hop beat, Diego, what would be your sound selection for the most part?
I'm gonna start with drums first, because it's gonna give me the energy as I'm making it to get into the beat. Yeah, I don't get bored of it. So first thing is the drums. I knock the drums out, and then I honestly, bro, like, I'll start with the melody, and then once I find a really, really catchy melody, I might do it on the keyboard, like a piano. I'll start running through sounds and try to find like a really different sound that I haven't used yet or that hasn't been used before. So I don't really believe in having a go-to like sound selection, because what happens is, one, all your shit starts to sound the same, and two, you start using the same instruments that everyone's using in these like YouTube sounding beats, where it's like, all right, pull up a piano for pain beat, pull up a guitar for pain beats. Like, try something different. Maybe use synth for pain beats. Maybe use, a guitar where you think a piano would be used. Just try to be different. And that's the way you stick out. If not, you're just going to be another YouTube producer forever.
Right. I like that. Giving y'all real bars. No, I just respect Diego for coming through, dropping bombs on y'all. There's so many highlights and clips from this alone. Man, you guys got blessed today. So the only way to thank him is to go follow him on Instagram. I'm going to link his Instagram in the YouTube chat. And then y'all can, you know, continue to follow him there to learn about his value. But again, check the announcements tab if you guys want to send stuff to Diego. Again, he's actually in the trenches making moves, not just talking fluff. And hopefully you heard a lot of stuff that I've been telling you, and he just reconfirmed everything that I've been telling you guys. Because again, Diego let me sit in his sessions, you know, for 8 hours. I'm watching how a pro songwriter, Rico Love, writes an actual song. He does not write. This man just closes his eyes and comes up with words. He's the master freestyler. You know, stuff like that. Diego, it's on you for any last thoughts. I want to wrap it under the hour. That way people who watch the replay can, you know, consume.
No, I appreciate y'all for listening, and you know, keep fighting the fight. Keep staying into the music. At the end of the day, remember what you do it for. You do it to make great music. The money comes, but don't forget that it's about the music first. Once you forget that, the money's never coming. So just keep creating and perfecting your craft. You'll never be perfect, but you'll keep perfecting it. Just the chase alone will bring you money. So that's it, really. I appreciate y'all.
Boom. Thank you.
Straight G, bro. He's a G, bro.
So he's a G. Thank you, Diego. I'm going to catch up with you. We have a lot of cool stuff coming down the pipeline with Diego. So we're going to keep you guys intact and on updated with that type of stuff. We'll have more conversations and stuff. But what else? Is there another takeaway? Yeah, his link's in the chat. Diego, I just want to say thank you, and I appreciate
you. Sure. Anything you need, bro, I'm always here, man.
Can you put them in the Hive?
Oh, the Hive. Yes, I will right now. So, Diego, I'm going to close the Zoom. That way my screen can free up. I appreciate
you. All right, boss. Appreciate you guys.
All right, I'll see you.
How's it going, Diego?
Let me do that. Okay, Diego's super dope. Oh, say put it in the Hive. That's a good point. You mean his Instagram, or do you mean
Yeah, like his links.
His links. Okay, yeah. And then I probably should make that look cooler, but I threw it in the Hive. I just want to thank you guys for, again, participating. Luca, forgive me. I had you on mute because sometimes the mic was kind of hitting.
I also asked, is a chapter book and a studio album is the same, or are they different?
Yeah, I think maybe the language is a little bit different for us. Maybe you mean like EP? Is that what you mean? Or I don't know what a chapter book is.
No, I was asking, is a chapter book, like a Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone? Like if you read like a chapter book, and then like a studio album, like if you listen to the album front to back, that's what I was thinking of.
Oh, like parallel